health is not just the absence of disease or infirmity, it's a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being. There may be more coverage of health in impact assessment and a realization of the links between biodiversity and livelihoods and human health. It could also go the other way in that people don't want to be bringing complicated issues like health into formal impact assessments.
How can we make environmental impact assessment better? We are back with this question after a pause of almost 1 year. Those who have been watching this channel know that last year I took a sabbatical leave in Canada and I started this web series on EIA. But earlier this year, we came back to Brazil and the pandemic hit the world. And long story short, I decided to focus on the Portuguese content of this channel. But now we are ready to resume and just in time for Christmas. The topic today is health impact assessment, COVID-19 and the future of EIA. To explore this topic, we have a very special guest, Ben Cave, the current president of the International Association for Impact Assessment. Ben Cave has a bachelor's degree in social anthropology from the London School of Economics. He also has a master's degree in health promotional sciences. And Ben is a truly global expert in health impact assessment and social impact assessment. Ben has also been publishing many articles and reports on the topic of health impact assessment. Without further ado, please enjoy the interview with Ben Cave. So Ben Cave, it's an honor to have you here in this humble YouTube channel. As you know, I'm going to be asking you 5 questions. But before I do that, maybe we should warm up this interview with a very basic but important question. What is IAIA?
So, good question. Nice to see you, Alberto. IAIA is the international network for impact assessment professionals. There are approximately 4,500 members across the world. Many of those are in the affiliates and branches. And there is indeed an affiliate in Brazil and in many other countries as well. IAIA puts out good practice. It offers mentoring. It offers training and webinars. In the usual run of a year, we have excellent conferences and face-to-face symposia. Obviously, now things are heading more towards online for the short term, we hope at least. But again, it's a fantastic opportunity to get together with people working in impact assessment and people using impact assessment well as well, because it reaches into so many different fields. So it cuts across all spheres of impact assessment, and it's great. So for people who are listening, if you want to get in touch, I'm sure you'll put the link up on the screen.
Absolutely.
And people can have a look at it. Yeah. Fantastic.
All right. So Ben, one of the things that IAIA has been providing us with is knowledge and information. And there's this new survey on COVID-19 and impact assessment. Could you please share with the YouTube audience the main takeaways of this survey?
The main takeaways are that impact assessment is as well, we know that it's a desk-based approach, but it also relies very heavily on talking with people and meeting with people. So the survey was carried out in the early days of the lockdown and the restrictions which were coming out. So the physical distancing was found by the people who took part to disrupt the profession, and you know, we depend upon fieldwork and travel. This was the people who took part in the survey felt this was like to continue with frequent changes. It found also that workarounds developed very much, that there was much more use of people who are on the ground. So again, impact assessment professionals who were well used to working with local experts then found, almost interestingly, the balance began to shift. And local experts become of increasing importance. As in all forms of life, there's a reliance on electronic communications for stakeholder consultation. That also is important and has, it has pluses and minuses to it. Not everybody is tech savvy and has a good internet connection. The other thing which is coming out is that impact assessment rules and regulations are being adapted to meet the restrictions which our societies are operating under. Another aspect that comes through is the way in which policymakers are adapting rules and regulations so that development can happen quicker. Now, this obviously can have adverse impacts for impact assessment, which is all about looking at things carefully and seeing what the impacts might be. So I think that's something to keep an eye on. And there are certainly examples around the world where processes are being changed. I think another thing that came, well, I know another thing that came out of the survey is that impact assessment is expected to have a useful role in pandemic recovery. Again, this wariness of the changes that might take place in regulations as we move into a recovery, and the phrase which is certainly used in the UK at the moment, which is building back better.
Well, I'm not sure if this is a finding of the survey, but I was talking to one of my colleagues during the first wave of the pandemic, and we were talking about the role of the pandemic in shedding light on the value of health impact assessment, or HIA. And we were assuming that after the pandemic, people would realize that we need more health impact assessment. But we are not HIA experts, so I have to ask you this question. Do you think that we're gonna have more health impact assessments because of the pandemic? And to what extent can health impact assessment mitigate public health problems?
I think that there may be more. I think we can go either of two ways. There may be more coverage of health in impact assessment and a realization of the links between biodiversity and livelihoods and human health. It could also go the other way, in that people don't want to be bringing complicated issues like health into formal impact assessments. So I was talking with a colleague about this question as well, a colleague, Mirko Winkler, who does lots of work. He's at the Swiss School of Tropical Public Health. And he said that that in his experience, that the way in which HIA has been used before for incorporating sort of outbreak or pandemic preparedness has been done, it's been done quite well, and HIA is well suited to that, but that it needs to be worked in more in a more thorough way right from the beginning, and that actually, certainly from a health point of view, it would be positive and beneficial. In fact, we should have more HIA, that there should be better screening protocols so that health is considered right at the early stages of the project and considered in a proportionate way as well. Because one of the issues about health is that it affects everything. So we need to find ways in which we have a proportionate approach to public health. Again, if we talked about pandemics before COVID-19, we would have said that is something which is, if it were to happen, would have a very high impact, but actually it's incredibly unlikely. So again, there's lots of good thinking about pandemic preparedness, but it was always pushed to the bottom of the list. So again, as we're thinking through screening for impact assessment, screening for health in impact assessment, we need to think about the probabilities that we're looking at.
So impact assessment is today present in virtually every country on Earth, but not necessarily mm-hmm. the subtypes of impact assessment, like social impact assessment, health impact assessment. I happen to be in Brazil, and in Brazil, we tend to address health issues as part of the broader impact assessment exercise. It's usually part of the socioeconomic impact assessment. But we could have standalone health impact assessment like we have in Europe. I wonder what's your view about this? Do you think that we should have more health impact assessment embedded in traditional project level EIAs, or maybe both? What's your take on that?
I think it comes back again to why we're looking at health within impact assessment, is that if it's done properly, it doesn't matter necessarily whether it's within an EIA or whether it's standalone. I think we need to make sure that we are looking at human health in a both a proportionate way, but in a way which public health specialists would recognize as being a good approach or a best practice approach. And certainly if you look at the literature on health in environmental impact assessment, there's quite a divide. The literature shows that health is looked at in environmental impact assessment, and it's ticked off, it's counted for, but it tends to be defined very narrowly. So health is defined in terms of its impact, or the way in which air quality impacts on health, the way in which water quality impacts on health, and noise, etc. So we get these sort of biophysical determinants, a focus on those. And then, so that's one half of the divide. If you then look at what public health practitioners and public health academics are writing about health impact assessment, they will tend to take the more comprehensive definition of health, which is given to us by the World Health Organization, of health is not just the absence of disease or infirmity, it's a state of complete physical, mental, and social well-being, which is far more aspirational and looking to the skies, really. And I think what we can see is, if we look to the legislation of environmental assessment, and we need to look to the legislation and the regulations, because that's very driven by that in environmental assessment, there's no reason why you can't look at a broader model of health, which brings in socioeconomic determinants and social aspects of health. It just tends to be defined narrowly because it's defined by people who would look at it narrowly. So it's not having the impact from public health. So strangely, one of the simplest questions if we go charging into looking at health impact assessment is the importance of actually defining what is health. What do we mean by health? And that then sets us off on a particular trajectory. And the other point is, it is critical to involve the health authority and specialists who are knowledgeable in public health, so that they can ensure that there is a proper consideration of human health effects. And just finally, is again, there's nothing intrinsically wrong in having a narrow definition of health in terms of environmental legislation. That's the way it's been done. But particularly in this year of all years, we can see how health really is linked with many, many aspects of life, and how you're missing out on a lot of the picture if you're not looking at this wider model of health. Also on health in EIA, we have just prepared a document with the European Public Health Association, which looks in detail at the Environmental Impact Assessment Directive of the European Union. And this is, as lots of legislation is, it's quite a complicated document. And so what we look to do with this document is to walk health authorities through what the process of EIA is and how they can get involved with it. And in so doing, we set out top tips and good practice actions and ways in which the health authority can help the developer and the competent authority, and ways in which those other two bodies as well can work to get health into EIA. There's a summary online at the moment. We are busy formatting the main report, and that will come out early in the new year.
Ben, you are an expert in health impact assessment, social impact assessment. But now you're the president of the International Association for Impact Assessment. I'm sure you're thinking not only about HIA, SIA, but the broader field in general. So I have to ask you a question about the future of impact assessment. What should be policymakers' main priorities with respect to impact assessment?
Use it, interrogate it, make it work for the project or the policy that it's being applied to. The danger is when impact assessment is used as part of the process. It's another set of hoops which we have to jump through. Actually, what you're getting when you're engaging in impact assessment is a knowledge of the process and knowledge of the development consent process, but also the application of science. So, and it's the application of science of not on a broader model. It's taking the findings from science and applying that to a very, very local, contextual and specific instance. And in doing that, in applying that science, it also needs to be talking with and engaging with people who live in the area and who are likely to be affected by the project or by the policy. So my plea, my recommendation, my firm advice to policymakers is that they actively engage with impact assessment and really interrogate it. It is something in lots of legislation that needs to be done. It is something that takes time and resources. It can provide huge benefits in both in getting people involved in the process and feeling wider ownership of a policy or a project. It also shows you some of the glitches in your design and shows you how to iron those out. And also, on a very basic level, if you're going to spend the money on it, get something good out of it. So really, really work the impact assessment professionals and get them to apply the science and to talk with local stakeholders.
Yeah, awesome. People are talking about the new normal. It's going to be a different world after the pandemic, and this is going to affect the EIA field as well. And to wrap up the interview, I have to ask this question. How is IAIA preparing for this new normal, this new post-pandemic world?
You may have seen that we were planning to have the 2021 conference in person in Seville, and there was an announcement that we would aim to do that. We took the decision quite recently to cancel that. The online conference the conference will now be wholly online. And there will be news coming out about that in the new year. But we're very excited about that. One of the things that comes through from the conferences is it's not just about the presentations and the sort of formal exchange of knowledge. It's also about meeting people and interacting and finding out what's going on in different parts of the world and learning about those experiences, as well as meeting up with friends. So we're looking to find ways in which we can have the platform have the conference on a platform which allows for those kind of interactions as well. So I think that's one immediate way. That will then obviously lead into a whole range of further webinars and ways in which the knowledge of the members of IAIA can be shared and can continue to be shared.
Perfect. We will make sure that all those links and resources are on the YouTube page. And that's it. Ben, thank you for your time. And for those who want to know more about Ben Cave, his consulting work, his role in IAIA, you should check some of the links on the YouTube page. All right, that's it for now, folks. I hope to see you again in the next interview.